Be careful, because this platform has poison. It's got power, it's also got poison. What do you mean? Lucifer had power. He had a platform, but the poison, what is the poison? The poison is, I'm so gifted, and people like me so much that I could turn their affection to me instead of pushing it to God. I got power, but I gotta get vaccinated against the virus of pride. Oh.
Yeah. Oh. That's right.
I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. 8 to 4. Run through the night, playing with your life. Going against the pack, that's risk in your life. Better play it right, and yeah, you better play it right.
Everybody stand up. Everybody stand up. Hey, if you're ready for the word, say yeah, yeah, yeah. If you're ready for the word, say yeah, yeah, yeah. Make some noise for the Lord, say yeah, yeah, yeah. Now everybody, somebody, give him the praise and just scream. God bless. Let's get into this word. Let's get into this word. Everybody go to Matthew chapter 17. Matthew chapter 17. Matthew chapter 17. God bless you, Relentless Church. Caden, put your mask up, boy. Cover your nose. It's my little nephew. He just, this is how he had his mask on. All of this is just COVIDious. Just I feel freedom in the room, and I feel joy rising in the room, and I'm gonna need moments of joy to break out. I'm gonna need a few surrogate worshipers for me. I've got to preach. So I'm gonna need a couple people to shout on my behalf and on behalf of my wife, my kids, because I'm gonna need to keep preaching. I need 7 intercessors to pray me through, because I sense that something's supposed to happen here that changes everything for all of us forever, that we will never be the same when these 30 minutes are over. I need somebody to pray me through so I can get this word to God's people. This is chapter 3 of the nonprofit series. The purpose of the series is to draw a line in the sand between that which is God and that which is not God, because there are people masquerading as voices from God that have no relationship with God, no intention of getting you to God, and all they really want is to build a kingdom to themselves, a cult of personality rooted in people worship that has nothing to do with the New Testament construct as seen in the book of Acts after the resurrection of Jesus Christ for the establishment of the kingdom purpose of the building of the church for the edification of the saints and the building of the body of Christ. Most people go to buildings on Sunday and leave the same way. Those days are over. We are in the last days. Stop playing games with God. And all of these false prophets and fake candy preachers giving you a sweet tooth so you can have a spiritual cavity in your soul. God is about to draw a line of delineation between voices that belong to him and those that do not. I'm grateful that I'm connected to a house that does not play with the person of Jesus and the power of Jesus. We are Relentless Church. And I'm grateful that you're here, so many of you, and to all those who are watching online. I want you to read with me. This is Matthew 17. It is a supernatural meeting. This is nonprofit chapter 3. The title of the message is Trilogy. Everybody say Trilogy. Trilogy means three. Star Wars was a trilogy. They come out in threes. It was Star Wars, A New Hope, Star Wars, Empire Strikes Back, Star Wars, Return of the Jedi. Some of y'all don't know that. Came out in 76. I was at the movies with my daddy and my mama. It's the only movie we all went to see together at the Twin Drive-In on Reading Road by the Norwood Lateral. Arthur Treacher's Fish and Chips was up the street. My daddy went and got some. I could still smell the vinegar. I asked him for a piece of fish. He said no. He was stingy. But that's not why my mama left him. Anyway, what I'm saying is this. He has some other things going on. But don't judge me, because your daddy was probably, you know. Anyway, let's get in the word. Shall we? Great. Matthew 17, starting at the first verse. Now, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John. Who'd he take? He took Peter, James, and John. How many is that? There's that trilogy. Took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves. Stop being afraid to be by yourself. Stop needing distractions. Why do you keep the TV on all night? You can't even let your soul rest. You have to listen to something. You have to have something. You can't even turn your phone off at night. Waking up at 2:43 because you got an alert because somebody liked a Facebook post. Go to bed. Then you angry at work, got an attitude, but you didn't get any sleep. We're afraid to be by ourselves because the truth is we don't know what the silence is going to say to us. Because oftentimes silence speaks louder than the words. He took them on a high mountain by themselves, Pastor Robert, and he was transfigured before them. Very important. Jesus was transfigured before them. They were not transfigured. He was. They were able to observe a supernatural occurrence. Watch this. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them talking with him. Freeze. They appeared to Peter, James, and John, but they were talking to Jesus. Tell somebody he wasn't talking to you. This is super important because there are people who won't understand what you saw. They won't understand your passion. They won't understand your prayer life. They won't understand your sacrifice. They won't understand your worship. They won't understand why you do what you do, but he wasn't talking to them. He was talking to you. Tell somebody he was talking to me. See, when God talks to you, your swag is different. When you know you have a relationship with God, you don't let people bother you like they used to when you didn't know who you were in Christ Jesus. When you know who you are, your eyes are a little wider. Your shoulders are a little more set. You don't slump over waiting on somebody to give you something. When you've been in your prayer closet, you come out, you already know what it is. When God talks to you, it doesn't matter who didn't hear it. I don't know about your vision. I don't see that. Well, it's good because it's not your vision. Stop letting people talk you out of your miracle because they can't see what God showed you. The Bible says Moses and Elijah appeared to them talking with him. Who were Moses and Elijah talking to? Jesus. So we got Peter, James, and John. We got Moses, Elijah, and Jesus. What's that? Another trilogy. Somebody say trilogy. Peter, James, and John. We got Moses, Elijah, and Jesus. Then you got the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's another trilogy. Oh, y'all gonna be seeing threes all week. Don't play 3-3-3. And if you do, get me a ticket. What I'm saying is this. Like, that is a word. Write that down. Watch this. Peter, my favorite disciple, he gets so excited. Joel, he always gets worked up. Peter's always blurting out something. You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. I got it right. Yeah. Same one. I'm like, I never heard of Jesus. I don't know who he is. He be shouting real loud, I love you. Then I never heard of you. Don't judge him. Because we check your life, you loud in here. But you real quiet out there. You sing all these songs, can't find not one of them in your car. You got a Sunday playlist different from the rest of the week. I'm not judging you. I'm just saying maybe that's why there's a challenge for you to get free from some stuff, because you still holding on. Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here three tabernacles. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, hey, this is my beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased. Hear who? Not Moses, not Elijah, hear him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, arise and don't be afraid. When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Somebody say, Jesus only. Jesus. Title of the message is Trilogy. Go ahead and be seated. I'm going to ask those who are taking notes to prepare, to get ready to write them down. Everyone else, if you have somebody near you that's distracted, gently shake them and say, listen to what the man of God has to say. This scripture is a profound moment of demarcation. Up until this moment, there was whispers, assumptions, curiosity, excitement, expectation around the person of Jesus. But as Jesus was walking one chapter earlier in Matthew 16 with his disciples, he asked them the question that would become the revelation that Jesus would then begin to establish the work of God's heart in the earth called the church, based on what Peter said. Jesus said, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say Elijah, some say John the Baptist, or one of the prophets. He said, but who do you say that I am? And then Peter says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus says, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I say to you, Simon, that you are Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Now, 6 days later, Jesus is on the top of a mountain being transfigured in order to prepare for the last leg of his earthly journey. He's being prepared to die for the sins of the world. For there is no other name whereby men must be saved. but by the name of Jesus. Jesus Christ is the full payment for sin. He is the spotless lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. He is the unique Son of God. He is spotless. He is sinless. He is the firstborn of heaven and the first begotten of the dead. He is the resurrection and the life. This is who my Savior is. Make no mistake, play no games with Yeshua HaMashiach, the prophesied Messiah. He is great and greatly to be praised. He is awesome. The Bible says, kiss the Son lest he be angry with you. You better read prophecy. God has established Jesus as the fullness of the Father's heart, will, mind, intention, and affection in the earth. If you want to know what the Father is thinking, look no further than the life of Jesus Christ. At this moment, 6 days after the revelation, he's at the top of a mountain. First thing that I want you to write down is that there's always a revelation before elevation. Are you guys hearing me? There's always a revelation before elevation. The problem with some places that call themselves the church is they are rooted in carnal knowledge. Knowledge that scintillates your intellect and stirs your emotions, but has no rooting in your soul. Nothing changes. Your affections don't change. Your behaviors don't change. The machinations of your life do not change. So you have been privy to a wonderful speech, but it is not the gospel, because the gospel forces you to make a decision. Thank you, sir. I said I needed 7 intercessors. I got 1. I said the gospel forces you to make a decision. We've got a lot of candy preachers who will tell you you can do what you want and live how you want and say what you want and treat people how you want. And as long as they look like you or vote like you or think like you, then y'all gonna have a special version of heaven different from the rest of us. But it's not heaven at all, because the reality is there is no other name whereby men must be saved. And so Jesus is not a politician. He is not a superstar preacher. Oh, God help me. We have too many people that utilize or use this sacred platform for their own agenda. This platform does not belong to me. This platform is for the preaching of the gospel. This platform is not my place of personal therapeutic expression. If I need therapy, go sit on a couch and pay a counselor. But I don't process, I don't do passive aggressive words to people that I don't like through this pulpit. I don't get to preach my mind, my will, my emotions, my thoughts, my musings. I am here to preach the gospel and point everybody to Jesus Christ. That is what the Bible says. Preach the word. Do I have any help in here? The Bible says that Jesus was at the top of the mountain and he had 3 men with him. Who were they? Peter, James, and John. But there were 12 disciples. Where were the other 9? They were down here at the bottom of the mountain. Because you can be near the mountain, but not be invited up the mountain. Some of you have been finding yourselves greatly frustrated, worship team, greatly frustrated, ushers, leaders, deacons, pastors, ministers, saints, friends, elders, elderesses, camera operators, miscellaneous sound technicians, lighting designers, and miscellaneous control room operators. You found yourself frustrated because some of your relationships are beginning to get on your nerves, and they're beginning to fray your edges because you keep trying to bring people up the mountain that weren't invited. I'm going to say it again. You are going to stay frustrated because you keep trying to bring people up the mountain that were not invited. Stop dragging people up the mountain that Jesus did not invite. The relationship did not work out. That is not your husband. That is not your wife. That is not your job. That is not your crew. Stop trying to bring them up. And one of the reasons you keep bringing them is because you don't believe you're worthy of elevation. So you're not bringing them out of excitement. You're bringing them out of shame and insecurity. You want security blankets, but the higher you go, the less weight you can carry. So you got to let go of the people, the places, the things, and the habits that have kept you hostage to a lesser version of yourself. Jesus is inviting you up the mountain, and everybody can't go. I need everybody to write this down, 25%. How many disciples was it? 12. How many went up the mountain? Okay, so that's 12 divided by 3 is what? 4. So it's 4 groups of 3. You take 3 groups of them 4, that's 75%, means only 25% made it up. You need to look at your circle right now. Everybody's not going. Choose your 25% and choose them wisely. I'm helping 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Am I helping my family from D.C.? Good. My D.C. family, Chocolate City, is in the house. Are you hearing what I'm saying, sis? Did you hear what I said? There's 25% of the people in your life designed to go to your next level. It does not mean you won't have relationship with the other 75%. It just means you have to relate to them differently. I'm not better than you. I'm just on a different level than you. Rashad, I don't know if this is a nice place for some of my friends, but then I've got another group that can come a little higher because they prayed with me. They understand. They've seen some of my pain up close. They understand the revelation of who I am. I don't have time to explain to you who I am as he's inviting me up the mountain. If I gotta go up the mountain and tell you who I am, then you're the wrong person. I need my Peter, James, and John who know exactly who I am. Peter got an invitation because he had a revelation. Stop inviting people into the upper inner court of your life who don't have a revelation of who you are, what you carry, or what you're called to. There are people who will stay connected to you because they don't know who they are and they don't have any of their own oil, so they're just gonna sit next to wherever the oil is. They'll put your jersey on and they'll cheer for you, but when life happens, they'll take your jersey off and they'll find another jersey to wear. That's why when Jesus went through it and they arrested him, everybody scattered. Help me, Holy Ghost. But Jesus still stayed faithful. That's why even after they scattered, when he got up, he restored Peter. There are some people in your life that are close, and they've been great for a season, but they're not called to go up the mountain. I need you to write this down, Elder D, because this is important for you. Rare air. Coleman, they didn't hear me, man. I said rare air. Do you understand? When you're going up a mountain, there's limited oxygen. You can't have people sucking oxygen at the next level that have nothing of value to offer. The reason why it's important that everybody doesn't go is because there's a limited supply of oxygen at elevated places. So if they're breathing the good stuff in. What goes out? The carbon monoxide, right? Dioxide, it comes out. But what comes out is the poison. I don't need you poisoning the atmosphere with what you speaking out. Stay at the base of the mountain. Just give me my 25%. Give me my Peter, James, and John. You need to identify the people that you can walk to the next level with. But then here's what happens. You got to be careful, because Peter got caught up. Jesus is there. All of a sudden, supernatural, bright like the light of the sun. His face was like the sun, and his clothes became white. And all of a sudden, boom, here comes Elijah. Boom, here comes Moses. Here's Peter. Jay, that's Moses. Yo, who is that? That's Elijah. Thomas, you shouldn't have doubted, bruh. He got so excited, he said, Jesus, hey, I'm glad to be here. Thank you for the invitation. Listen, I see you got your friends with, hey, Moses, what up, Mo?
Moses.
What up, Elijah? He was up in the whirlwind. I heard about that. That's crazy. Why don't I build three tabernacles, three tents, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah? Peter, I appreciate you, but they weren't talking to you. Nobody asked you to build a monument to a moment. My mama said, keep going. Don't be moved. Just keep preaching. Keep pushing along. Moses. Why was Jesus meeting with Moses? What were they talking about, Moses and Elijah? Why were they talking with Jesus? What were they talking about? Well, the low-hanging fruit, family, is that Moses represents the law. Elijah represents the prophets. The Bible says that Jesus is the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. My first theological mind, spirit-filled mind, says perhaps they were going over strategy to make sure that Jesus had fulfilled the righteous requirement of the law and that he had fulfilled every prophetic declaration of who he was, starting with Deuteronomy 18, that Moses prophesied there will be a prophet, capital P, that will come from among you, from your brethren, and him you will hear in all things. And so Moses actually represents the mixture of the law and the prophet. But then Elijah represents the mantle of the prophetic. And so Jesus is meeting because he is the fulfillment of both. But then the Spirit of God spoke something else to me that I'm offering to you. And I believe that this is going to give hope to some of you and encouragement to many others. Why Moses? Why Elijah? How come not Elisha? He got the double portion. How come not Micah, Nahum? What's up with Job? He went through hell. How come he ain't on the mountain? Well, let's talk about the last place we saw Moses. God said, let me show you the promise from an elevated vantage point, from the top of a... The last time we see Moses, he's at the top of the mountain. He's looking at the promise that he can't enter because he didn't hallow the name of the Lord in front of the people. He missed his promise because of people. Don't you miss your promise fooling with people. Don't you let anybody get you distracted to the point that you push everybody else into their promise and you sitting on the outside of your own looking in. You better preach. I'm gonna keep going. Moses, we see on the mountain. Then the Bible says God buried him. I need you to know God is a grave digger. He's a funeral director. He's an undertaker, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And why did God bury Moses? Because God knew that if he didn't bury Moses and the people did, they would build a monument to who Moses was, to what he represented and to what he used to do. They would never want to go to the promise because they so worried about him. They would have made him a god and forgot the God who made Moses. He buried him on the mountain. Elijah, we see him. 400 prophets of Baal versus Elijah. And Elijah said, the God that answers by fire, that's God. Cuz, represent. Elijah, Most High, Yahweh. Yay, yay. What happens? God swoops down, consumes the whole offering and the water around it, the wood and everything around it. And then Elijah says, kill all of these false prophets. I need you to know it's going to be some people that's going to leave up out of here early playing with God. That's all I'm going to say. And I'm not talking about the human condition, making mistakes and repenting. I'm talking about people that are willfully leading God's people astray. They're going to start dropping like flies. 400 prophets of Baal killed. Then he gets a letter from Jezebel. And she says, may the gods do to me and more also if you are not like one of them by this time tomorrow. And he takes off running. Because of a letter from a woman. A wicked, manipulating spirit. And let me tell you something. That's a whole nother sermon. That a man that powerful can be moved by a witch. Don't think there still aren't witch spirits. There's some witches out here. There's some warlocks out here. That's why you gotta be discerning. Because the best witch you don't know until it's too late. The Bible says Elijah ran. Where did he run? Any Bible scholars? To the mountain of God. Mount Horeb. So Elijah met God on a mountain. And what did God say to Elijah when he got there? What are you doing here? You're a prophet, but you out of place. You let this Jezebel get you out of place. The spirit of Jezebel always attacks the prophetic. She wants to kill that voice because she can't manipulate it. Oh, the spirit of Jezebel wants to manipulate the prophetic and pervert justice and leadership. But the God that I serve is exposing that devil all over the body of Christ, and he's raising up mighty men of God that are not moved by their flesh or their carnality and will not bow down to the spirit of Jezebel. Elijah was on a mountain. Moses was on a mountain. Both of them were discouraged. Moses did not get to the promise. He could see the promise, couldn't enter it. Elijah, arguably the greatest Old Testament prophet we have, his conversation with God is, I want to die because I feel like I'm the only one left. Anybody ever felt like that? No judgment here, no judgment zone. You ever felt everybody else is living however they want, doing dirt and still being successful, twerking, still being successful. I can't find one good man, and she got four. And all of them belong to somebody else, but she got them. Nobody wants to talk about what you really praying. Maybe if I just start hoeing out, maybe I can have some fun too. What's holiness gonna do? I've been living holy. It ain't got me nothing but frustrated. I'm taking all the cold showers, ice baths, ain't nothing. I know we got kids, but nobody wants to tell the truth that sometimes you've been mad with God and you wanted to give up. I know about it. I've been there. How do you go from the top of the mountain to straight into the valley? He said, it's enough. I want to die. God said, listen, go anoint Jehu king in place of Ahab, and then go anoint Elisha prophet in your place. God shifted his assignment when he saw his condition. Because even prophets get discouraged. Even leaders miss the mark. But it doesn't change where they were. They were still on the mountain. Oh, Lord, help me. So now, where do we find Moses and Elijah? But on the mountain where we last saw. And who are they talking to? They're talking to Yeshua HaMashiach, the fulfillment of the thing that you wrote, Moses. I wrote it, but you handed it to the people. And everything that you represent, Elijah, is right here. What this represents is the faithfulness of God to show you the promise even when you thought it was over. Moses didn't see the promised land. Elijah prophesied so many things, and the Father in his love, I believe, allowed Moses and Elijah to see the fulfillment of what it is they were talking about. That's why God corrected Peter and said, hey, you don't build tabernacles to Moses and Elijah like they're Jesus. They are not Jesus. They point to Jesus. The law frustrates men into realizing I could never keep the law. That's why Jesus had to be the fulfillment of the righteous requirement of the law. Spotless, sinless, fulfilled the law, but also the prophecy. All three of them are on the mountain, but they're not the same. Okay, y'all missed it. Let me say this. Oh, Lord, help me. This is super important. Just because they were on the same mountain didn't mean they were on the same level. God said, don't you put the law on the same level as the fulfillment of it. And don't you put the prophecy on the same level as the fulfillment of it. Because what did 1 Corinthians say? 1 Corinthians 13:8 says, but whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. Got a lot of people with knowledge, but no revelation. Oh, Lord. The devil knows the word. He just don't have revelation. Because in order to have revelation, you need the Holy Ghost. Watch this. For we know in part knowledge. We prophesy in part supernatural. But when that which is perfect, Jesus, has come, then that which is in part will be done away. I've done away with the law. I fulfilled the prophecy. Stop building monuments or tabernacles to the law. There are still churches that want people to hold to the law. You better do everything in the law. Don't eat this. Don't eat that. Don't mix fabrics. Don't do that. You better lay down Friday night and don't get up till Saturday night. Because if you don't, you're going to dishonor God. You're going to go to hell. And all of that is what Jesus came to fulfill. You sitting up trying to fulfill the righteous requirement of the law. You're not even Jewish. You were grafted in. You're a Gentile. You trying to hold on to a promise that didn't even have your name on it. The only reason you could get to God is because he expanded the family of God through faith. This is good teaching. Then you got other people all they want to do is prophesy. They'll go to prophetic conferences. And, oh, I'm going to the prophetic service, and everybody's going to get prophesied a house. And everybody's getting a car. You're going to get a husband or a new husband, or God's going to turn your husband around. He ain't thinking about you. You're going to have $1 million 10 years later. You still sitting up on premium, top level, mid-level managerial position. And here's why. Because they weren't prophets, they were psychics. And the difference between a psychic and a prophet is that psychics deal with familiar spirits, demons. I'm trying to help y'all. When prophets speak, God backs them. Psychics will tap into your emotions and look at empirical data and say what you want to hear. But prophets don't care what you want to hear. This is what God said. You do with it what you want. I'm out of here. The law pointed to Jesus because only he could fulfill it. All of the prophecies pointed to Jesus. My point is this. In this season, find voices that will point you to Jesus. Stay away from people that will point you to themselves and make you think that they're the only ones that you can hear from. You know the voice of the Lord. You know the discerning of the Holy Spirit. You better try the Spirit by the Spirit and stop listening to everything and dining on everything and intaking everything. Hear me by the Spirit of the Lord. Jesus was at the top of the mountain. Transfigured, Trilogy, Peter, James, and John, Moses, Elijah, and Jesus, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Moses didn't get the promise. Elijah left in a whirlwind. It's almost like it was incomplete. That's why his mantle was in the earth, because the job wasn't done. It's almost like they were a part of a story. And they had never all been together until this moment. And what I need you to know is I believe they were talking strategy, because Jesus was getting ready to run his leg of the race. Oh, I'm getting ready to help somebody. See, Moses got the people to the promised land. But here's the key. The promised land is not a land. The promised land is a person. Jesus is the promise. Oh, my God. Everybody wants land. If you get Jesus, you get the land. If you get Jesus, you get the prophecy. If you get Jesus, you get the healing. If you get Jesus, you get the salvation. Stop trying to get the stuff. Just get to Jesus, and all these things will be. I need a 10-second praise break in here. I'm trying to help somebody. The sermon is almost over. I just need to know, do I have a church? I said the promised land is not a place, it's a person. Jesus is the promise. Oh, Lord. Moses ran his race. Me, Delroy, I was a big track and field fan. I grew up during the days of Carl Lewis, 1984 Olympics in L.A., Greg Louganis, all of them. I remember Carl Lewis. I remember 88, Michael Johnson running the 400. But one of my favorite races is the 4x100. Anybody ever ran track in here? Don't let this body fool you. I was on the sixth grade track team. Wait a minute. We didn't do our push-ups, did we? All the men, get up. I ain't playing. We're going to do these push-ups.
You got a race to run. Let's go.
Now, all the ladies, I need you to stretch. Come on, stretch. Do something, ladies. Come on, stretch. While the men are gaining muscle, ladies, God's calling you to stretch. Your gifts need to stretch. Your vision needs to stretch. Your prophetic insight needs to stretch. Ladies, I need you to stretch. Your body was designed to stretch. That's why you can allow your stomach to stretch, to let a baby be growing and then push it out, because you have an elasticity and then you bounce back. I'm prophetically declaring a bounce back anointing on God's women. What you lost, you're gonna bounce back. What you think broke you, you're gonna bounce back. Those are not wounds. Those are glory marks, not stretch marks. That's the glory of God that has stretched you in the spirit. I'm trying to help somebody in here. Tell somebody, run your race. The meeting on the mountain, Pastor Joel, was about the passing of the baton. Moses, Elijah, the law, and the prophets, and then Jesus. Jesus said, Moses, I'm the fulfillment of what you started. Elijah, I am the fulfillment of the prophecies. It's my turn. Hand me the baton. Y'all missed it. I need two runners. Come on. If this is Moses in Deuteronomy 18, he prophesied. And here's the thing about a 4x100 relay. Let's stretch. We got to get ready. See, you can't start running from a cold stop. You got to be in this thing for a while. If you don't have history with God, you don't need to be running right now. Because in this season, we need people that are not scared of the opponent. You can't be scared of who's in the aisle next to you or in the... What's the thing called? The lane. Run your race. Tell somebody, run your race. I want you to put this in the chat feed. Stay in your lane. I'm not trying to run your race. I don't want your anointing. I don't want your gift. I don't want your assignment. I want to be faithful to my assignment. The key to the 4x100 is not just speed. It's the ability to pass the baton. And if you don't pass the baton properly, the entire team gets disqualified. And Jesus said, I want to make sure that we pass the baton right. So Moses started, and when you're running, you gotta run. And here's the thing, whoever's running first can't slow up. The person in front of them has to start moving like they already have the baton. Don't pass off your anointing, your gift, or your calling to somebody that's not already running. And when you pass the baton, you gotta make sure they grab that thing. Because if you drop it, everybody gets disqualified. Tell somebody, don't drop it. Your great-grandmother prayed for you to be here right now. Don't drop it. Your great-great-grandfather was in a field somewhere, owned by another human being, asking God for deliverance. Don't drop it. You are the fulfillment of prayers and prophecy. Somebody say, don't drop it. Elijah got the baton. But now on the mountain, the law and the prophets now see the one that's running the next leg of the race. I need you to know it's the anchor leg. His name is Jesus. And we passed it off. And Jesus ran for 33 years without spot or blemish. And he ran all through Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, Capernaum, Syrophoenician women, lepers, oh, the woman at the well, the woman with the issue of blood, running, feeding 5,000, 4,000 at a time. Jesus raising up Lazarus, Jesus preaching from a boat, Jesus talking to the storm, running his race all the way to the cross. And it was on the cross where it looked like the enemy won. But instead of passing the baton, he stretched out his hands. I wish I had a worshiping church in here. He was on a cross. He was standing still, but he was still running his race. Did you know you can stand still and you be running your race? I don't know who this is for. Don't you move. Just by staying where you are, you're running your race. The Bible says that Jesus laid down his life, endured the cross, despising the shame. Looked like the race was over. Ken, he died. But the problem is the enemy underestimated the power of the anchor leg. Because 3 days later, when they went home, Jesus got out of the ground and ran to the finish line. And he sprinkled his blood on the mercy seat. And he said, all power has been given to me in heaven and in earth. It was on the cross. Jesus said these three words. It is... I need somebody to shout if you know he finished the race. No, you're not shouting like Jesus finished the race. Here's what's crazy. He finished the race, but he still has the baton. And what did he say? Go into the whole world, making disciples, baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, which means he's the anchor leg. He finished the race. But a 4x100 relay don't just have three. It has four. What if I wanted to tell you, you're the anchor leg? Before Jesus comes back, we got a job to do. Can he trust you with the baton? Can you run your race? Can you stay faithful? And here's the thing, you're not running for victory, you're running from victory. You've already won. All you needed to do is grab the baton and be faithful. My job is to make sure that when it's my job finished, I pass the baton to my son and my daughter, and they pass it to their children until Jesus comes back. I need a church to stand up. The sermon is coming to a close, but can God trust you with the baton? Jesus finished the race, but now he still wants you to run. Can he trust you? Who am I passing this baton to? Who wants it? I said, who wants it? You notice some of them didn't clap. I appreciate that. Some of them, I'm not sure if I really want to take it. Doesn't matter if you want to or not. You got on your track shorts. You got saved. You gave your life to Jesus. You on the field. Fourth quarter in the earth. Time is short. It's a trilogy. Peter, James, and John. And in the deep, Jesus was transfigured. But the last person standing was John. He was fourth quarter in that dispensation. He wrote the revelation. What's the revelation God wants you to write? Today, there's some people who need to give their lives to Jesus. Listen to me very carefully. This is not a game. Jesus wants to save your soul. Don't play with hell. There's nothing in hell you want. Don't you listen to these fools talking about it's going to be a party. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I know some of you have to go to work. If you do, God bless you. But for the rest of us, there's an entire hurricane in New Orleans that could have been coming up the South Carolina coast. The least we can do is just stay till the end. Your reservations at the restaurant are not that deep. Somebody here needs to give their life to Jesus. There are others who need to be a part of this church. You want to be covered? You want to join this church? This is your moment. Matter of fact, everybody do me a favor. Sit down. I messed up. I don't want you standing for a long time. Everybody sit down. Will, be ready. Elder Will don't play. I love it. But I want y'all to hear me. If you're here, you're never giving your life to Jesus, or you know that God is calling you to be a part of this church community, when I count to three, I want you to stand and I want you to walk this way. I'm believing for a harvest of souls and new members. One, two, three. Stand all over this place if I'm talking to you. You need to get it right, or you need to join this church. You need to rededicate. Come on, we can do better than that. Y'all gonna do better than that. There are others that are coming. We're gonna keep clapping as more come. Welcome home. Pastor Megan, come on over here. Stand with Elder. Stand on the other side of this young lady. Who else is coming? Oh, 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 oh. Sitting there wondering if God is talking to you. I got one question. Has God not seen you through? Come to the altar. Give the Lord your life. He'll take away all your pain. He'll take away all your strife. New life is waiting on you. Hope and healing. Everything you've been through, God knows what you're feeling. All you gotta do is stand up, start walking this way. The elders will meet you halfway. Come right here, walk with her, don't let her be alone. For somebody on the outside, you need to hear, welcome home. Right now, right now, right now, right now. Somebody open up your mouth, give the Lord your hands. Somebody just came to the altar, it's a young man. So grateful for you. This is your son. Bless you, man of God. God is moving in this place. This your family? Welcome home. This is unbelievable. Is there anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Is there anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Oh, oh. Don't wait. Next week is not promised. I'ma give you a few more moments. Think about your life. Are you in bondage or are you free? Hell or eternity? Listen to the words, listen to my voice. Don't leave out of this church till you make your choice. Here they come walking down. There ought to be a praise up in the atmosphere, a sound. Oh, 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 oh. Stay right there. No matter the season, winter, spring, summer, fall, somebody else in here needs to make their way to this altar call. I'm not begging, but I really am hoping. Stop your complaining, talking real sad and moping. God has given you freedom and deliverance. He wants to give you the Holy Ghost and temperance. Ooh, yeah. Here they come. Here comes the harvest. Is there anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Is there anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Break it down. This ain't about good or bad or how well you can behave. There's only one name, Jesus Christ, on which men can be saved. You better call on him while you have this chance. 'Cause one day everyone in here is gonna have to stand before God who made the souls of all men. You gonna have to confess your good and all of your sins. So if I were you, I wouldn't play no games. 'Cause there's one who's above every name. Just give him your life. His name is Jesus Christ. There they come. I was waiting on you. 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 Is there anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Is there anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Welcome home. I said, welcome home. For those who are online, text the word saved to 95555. Text the word saved to 95555. to all my family here, I'm so grateful that you responded to God's call. Your family is blessed. You're a mighty man of God. Grateful for the young son, your legacy. And that was his decision. You didn't force that on him. He heard from God. Because that young man is a prophet. That young man is going to speak to nations. Brilliant academic mind. There's nothing he can't process. He does not think like other young boys his age. He's so advanced. God is speaking to him, speaks through him. This boy will be able to read scripture and get revelation that the best preachers in the world haven't seen. Y'all are blessed. Your family is blessed. Your seed is blessed. And God's not done blessing this house. I feel the Holy Ghost. Hey, man, welcome. I'm so proud of you. So proud of you. Bless you. Bless you. Everybody here and everybody online and everybody in the church, stand up with me. We're going to say this together. Lord Jesus, it's me. I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that Jesus is Lord. Thank you for the blood that was shed for me. Is she coming? Come on. Even while I'm praying, God is still saving. Even while we're praying, God is still saving. Even while I'm praying, God is still saving. Did she come or she just hanging with mommy? Come on up here. All right, I haven't done this in a while. But Elder Will told me last night, he said, the Holy Ghost said, don't rush. Don't rush service today. There's a man here. All of this has hit your spirit and you're like, yo, I don't know if I'm supposed to go down there. This is your confirmation to come down. So many people are counting on you to make a move to this altar. So come on, man of God. Don't have us waiting. If it's you, there he is. Elder Johnny, come stand with that young man. He's walking. See him? And here's another one. Stay with him right here. Bring him up. Bring him up right here. My man. Stay with him. Everybody got a hand on their shoulder. Get up on him. Here he comes. Who am I talking to? Somebody else needs to make their way. I believe we're waiting on one more. Where are you? Stay right there. This last person, you've been hurt by the church and you blamed God. But what man did was not God's fault. Are you coming? Are you coming? Yes, you. Look at it. She walked right down. Y'all missed it. We clapping. Our sister just came down. Lord. All right. Somebody, you a real hard case. You back there like, I'm not going. You don't feel worthy. It ain't your blood, and it's not your story. Come on down, get a brand new robe. It's about who you know, not about what you do. Jesus will see you through. Come get with your crew. You might even get a new boo. Am I talking to you? Come on and come on, get saved. There it is, there it is, there it is, there it is, there it is. There she is. Come on. Y'all can do better than that. Everybody, somebody else coming? Is he? You're like me, you just don't fit in. So much on your heart, where do you begin? You pray to the Lord at night, looking out your back window, wondering, God, do you hear me? Do you know? Here he comes. We've been waiting on you. We've been waiting on you. We've been waiting on you. Brandon, go over. He's a young man. Come on over here. Just stand with him for a second. Everybody here, welcome home. Text me. Holler at me. I got a pair of Travis Scott's for you if you come down. I'm just playing. That's bribery. But I'm for real. I'm just playing. Unless you're gonna do it. Nobody's leaving here that doesn't need to be saved. Tomorrow's not promised. Final plea. If you were to die in 10 minutes, are you absolutely sure you would go to heaven? If you are not completely sure, get to the altar now. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 2, 2. Look at this. coming? Are you coming? Welcome home. I need some of the fellas. Don't just push him, shake his hand. Tell him, welcome home. Kason. What's up, Kason? How you doing, buddy? You all right? Yeah? What else?
Hello.
Hello? That's right. Say Jesus. Jesus. You're thinking it. Are you coming? Are you already a part? Right. Everybody at the altar, say this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, it's me. I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that Jesus is Lord. Thank you for the blood that was shed for me. I receive the free gift of salvation, not through my works, but the finished work of the cross. The blood is enough to pay for all my sins. Now, Holy Spirit, come live inside and teach me how to be more like Jesus each and every day. You are my Savior and my Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You prayed that prayer, you're saved. And you're now a part of our Relentless Church family. I need somebody to act absolutely. Listen, before you leave, everybody, I need you to walk this way. We're walking this way. We're following Pastor Robert. Everybody walk. I'm not going to take you. I'm not taking you. I love you. I don't want you. Your mama loves you. Your daddy loves you. Come on, let's clap. Let's clap as our family leaves. Let's clap. Look at this. Look at this harvest. Come on, they still walking. We clap till they leave. Isaiah, we're living in the glory days. I said we're living in the glory days. I said we're living in the glory days. There's glory in the house. There are miracles in the house. Yes, sir. May the Lord bless you and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you, show you his favor, and give you his peace. We'll see you on Wednesday, first Wednesday pursuit night, baptism in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. Everybody needs to be here. 151 people getting baptized in the water. Somebody ought to bless God. Don't mind me. Service is over, but my worship is not. God bless you. As Pastor Lamores gives us instructions, go in peace. serve the Lord.